Fireside Chat, episode 22, the season opener. Recorded September 27th, 2013.
It's time for another episode of Fireside Chat, featuring Dan, Matt, and Lucas.
It's the start of the 2013-2014 NHL season. It's also the start of Season 2 here on Fireside Chat. This is our season opener, and I'm Dan alongside Luke and Matt again. Gentlemen, how you doing?
Very good.
I'm terrific. I want to know how last season's cliffhanger is going to resolve.
Last season's cliffhanger is going to resolve that we finally announced, Feasters finally told everyone that we are indeed rebuilding.
Dun, dun, dun.
Well, guys, training camp is now over. We're recording this a couple days before the start of the season. So I figured let's just take some time and reflect on the training camp. Is there anyone that you guys thought should have been cut or shouldn't, that did or didn't get cut? What do you think the roster looks like? Any surprises? Matt, why don't you start and give us your thoughts on the training camp and how it's shaken down so far?
Well, I've been impressed thus far with how well everybody's performed. And one of the things that I've noticed this year, as opposed to last year and before, is the amount of work ethic in the training camp, not only from the kids, but also from the veteran players. It's a very different atmosphere on the ice, as opposed to years past, where the team would get by more so on talent instead of work ethic. So that's always good. And plus, a lot of the players are learning the good habits of always giving everything on their shifts, so that's a lot better. As for the players, some have struggled, some have done really well, like Lance Boma, so yeah, it's a good evaluation, and hopefully those that got cut, they try to perform well in Abbotsford to try and get back up here.
Luke, what about you? What are your thoughts on training camp?
Well, I don't think that anyone got cut who shouldn't. I'm mainly happy that Steve Beja is not here. As we all know, I was not a huge fan of Monsieur Beja and his just occupying of a roster spot that could have gone to someone on the right side of 30. The roster looks pretty much exactly the way I thought it would look, although I think it's interesting that in everyone's, it seems most people's final lines for the beginning of the year, we've got so much filler, I suppose, or maybe you want to call it depth, that people leave off people like David Jones or Gagliardi just completely off the main roster, I think because they just forget they're on the team. But no one's here who shouldn't be, I think, except Butler.
We all know your thoughts on Butler.
Yeah, him and Beja. I like Beja more than Butler.
That tells us a lot about your feelings on Butler.
I appreciate that Beja plays a role. I just would rather see someone else have it. Chris Butler, go away.
We heard all your Butler rants last year, so I think we're all familiar with your thoughts on Butler. And unfortunately, he didn't go away in the offseason. He got re-signed, so obviously somebody on the team thinks he's worth his weight.
Yeah.
You know, Luke, it's funny. You mentioned the word depth, and depth wasn't a word I expected to associate with the team this year. I mean, this is a team that's in a rebuild, a team that people have said for a while the cupboards are bare. Depth normally isn't a word that's associated with the team that year. So I think if we're starting to see that and feel that, that's a good thing.
It is, but I would argue, I don't have much feeling on this yet just because I haven't seen them play enough, but I feel like this is the kind of depth that is like the middle of the Atlantic Ocean is deep, but there's, until you get to the very bottom, there's not a lot there. This is the same sort of situation. Like, yeah, okay, we've got three lines of second and third line talent, but that's the problem. We have one first line player. He'd be a second line player on any contending team.
But isn't that kind of what you expect in a rebuild, though?
Oh, for sure. I love it. It's still weird to wrap your head around.
It is. As far as training camp goes, anyone that not necessarily guys that got cut that shouldn't, but I guess a surprise to me was that Corbin Knight got cut. The team was really promoting him and Max Reinhardt for that matter. I really thought one or both of those guys would have an opening day spot, and they're both on their way down to the Heat. So not necessarily that I think they should be there, but that was surprising to me based on the organization's opinion of them. That's probably a surprise. I mean, Matt told us last time we've recorded that Corbin Knight was the best faceoff guy we've got.
Well, I mean, here's the thing with that. I suppose I don't look nearly as much into reassignments and who makes this team out of camp as I would, say, last year, because I fully expect, I don't know, I would say at least six guys, if not closer to 10, who are currently on the Heat to get looks in the NHL at some point this year. It's going to be a long year. There's going to be injuries. There's going to be trades once the deadline hits. So I'm not worried that a guy fresh out of the NCAA isn't quite ready, but if he's that as far along as he looked in prospect camp, and like he didn't look too out of place in the preseason games I've seen, it's just that Monahan and Horak have been better.
Yeah. And, you know, I think that, like you said, and Matt and I have talked about on a previous show, we are going to see a lot of guys wear a flaming C this year. I think that there's going to be a lot of guys that will get a cup of coffee, and Matt and I talked about this before the show too, a lot of guys who are going to get the chance to lose their spot. They're going to be given a spot because we don't have a lot of first and second line guys, and it'll be theirs to lose. So I definitely think there's going to be a lot of turnaround this year.
Yeah, with Knight getting sent down, I was a little disappointed, but I could understand why. Because it's always better with a young player like that to have him get first-line minutes instead of being like the 12th or 13th forward. Yeah, I probably would have kept him over Horak just for the face-off skills, but you know, that's a toss-up. They both performed equally in my mind. So, you know, it's just one of those things. But, you know, we'll likely end up seeing 45 or so players play for the Flames at various points through the year, even if they're only playing a game or two here and there. So, you know, it'll be interesting to see. And, you know, I'd almost be more interested in seeing how the Heat do over the course of the season than the Flames, just due to all the various prospects that we have down there and how they'll fare.
Yeah, for sure. And the other thing is, like, I think every, like, as good as Knight's been on faceoffs, I think at this point the organization would want to give any draw that Knight's going to take to Monahan to see what he can do. And if Monahan gets his 9 games and goes back to the OHL, which at this point seems unlikely based on how he's been raved about, I think it's pretty clear that Corbin Knight's probably the first guy they call back up to fill that slot.
Yeah, that's an interesting, I wasn't thinking about that, but yeah, it could just be that Corbin Knight's going to go down, because maybe Monahan's even just going to play the first 9 games here and then be reevaluated. He'll be sent to the WHL, and Corbin Knight will come back. So I didn't think about that, but yeah, that's very feasible as well.
So shall we go into roster predictions?
Sure. So it's Friday the 27th when we're recording this, so final cuts haven't been made yet, but we thought it'd be fun to each do our predictions for the final cuts. So as of right now, Friday the 27th, the Flames are sitting with a 28-man roster. They have 16 forwards, 9 defensemen, and 3 goaltenders. And that means they need to cut 2 forwards, 2 defense, and 1 goaltender to get to the 23-man roster that Feaster said he wanted to carry this year. So, Matt, why don't you give us your predictions for who you think is going to be cut?
Well, Feaster said that they were going to be going with 14 forwards, 7 defensemen, and 2 goalies. And of the bubble forwards, you have Ben Street, Blair Jones, Roman Horak, Tim Jackman, and, according to Feaster, Sven Berchi. For me, I think that both Blair Jones and Ben Street have been on the lowest end of those 5 players. So that would likely be my 2 cuts, even if both Horak and Berchi might not be getting as much ice time as they need. For the defenseman, Chris Breen, he's only still up due to him being injured, and he'll likely be sent down as soon as he's better, leaving Brody Butler, Giordano O'Brien, Russell Seeloff, Smith, and Weidman as the other 8. And Seeloff, being 19, will likely end up going to the AHL. Leaving Butler, O'Brien, and Russell being the bottom pairing guys. And with the goalies, personally, from what I saw of Ramo, Berra, and McDonald, I thought Berra was the best in terms of being composed in the crease of the 3. But, neither Berra or Ramo have to clear waivers to go down, whereas McDonald does. So from an asset management point of view, it might make sense to send Berra down instead. But if you're going based off of meritocracy, I would have Ramo as the starter and Berra as the backup, each getting more or less equivalent ice time. It'll be interesting.
So almost a 1A, 1B.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how they evaluate that.
So your prediction for goalies is that Berra gets sent down and Ramo keeps the NHL job?
Yeah.
Okay, I think that's fair. And Luke, what about you? Who do you think are going to be the 5 cuts?
Well, let's stick on goalies for a sec, because I'd agree with Matt that Berra and Ramo have both looked more impressive than Joey McDonald. And with that said, the argument against keeping both rookies up is going to be, lack of experience. Well, what's the worst that can happen? We're going to suck more? Like, you know what Joey McDonald is, and he was decent enough last year. He put up better numbers than Kipper. But 2 unknowns at this age where goalies really start to figure it out is, to me, more valuable and more worthwhile than maybe this will work. One unknown and 1, 8, 9, and 1. That's just my feeling. If we want to go work back up in inverse order to Matt, go to defense. Unfortunately, I have to agree with my esteemed colleague here that Breen and Seeloff at the moment would be the odd guys out. Though truthfully, not been impressed with Shane O'Brien a huge amount. Thoughts on Butler are well known. Seeloff is not, I don't think, ready to just step into the NHL. He needs Troy Ward to mold him for at least a couple months. And you know what? I feel like he and Wotherspoon are going to be a tandem up on the big club in the near future. So more time to get that pairing some chemistry, the better. Because I think that is actually going to be a very good homegrown bit of talent for us growing forward. Up front, if I've only got to take 2, I wasn't even aware Blair Jones was still here. Based on everything I've seen this preseason, he has been beyond invisible. And Ben Street, yeah, he had a decent enough game, but he's not good enough to be a top 6 player, and certainly not versatile enough to be a bottom sixer. So I Yeah, Street and Blair Jones have got to go for me. Tim Jackman's actually had a pretty impressive season, all things considered. He looks like he did 3 years ago when he was very effective.
I think that when I'm looking at this roster and who I'd cut, I'm pretty much on the same page as you guys. I think Ben Street and Blair Jones I'd both send down. I don't necessarily think that they will stay down. I don't necessarily think that other guys won't come up, but those are the guys I'd send down to start with. On defense, I think Seelov will turn pro, but not NHL pro. I think he'll be playing in the AHL for a while. I think he will get a shot at the NHL level later in the season, but I think he starts with Abbotsford. And Breen, I definitely send down. I was debating between Breen and Derek Smith, but yeah, I think Breen's the guy I'd send down there. And I really think that Ramo is the guy we have to have as a starter. I think Red O'Bara will do better and have more chances to play and win at the AHL level.
Yeah, that's reasonable, for sure. It's just I don't think Ramo is he's certainly not a big minute starter at this point. And I think having someone who could be capable of pushing him for starts like Berra is more useful than someone who's just going to take 20 or 30 starts and, you know what you're getting.
So let's talk about that. How many starts do you think Ramo will have?
Honestly, I think, well, he'll get as many as he deserves, which is a non-answer, I suppose. But if you think about it, I mean, assuming that all three of these guys, I mean, let's assume that Joey McDonald and Kari Ramo start the season here. Ramo, I would say, probably gets 45 games. McDonald gets 25 to 30, and Berra takes the rest. Or does that leave us with anything? That might not.
Yeah, that'd leave Berra with a dozen.
Yeah, that would give Berra a dozen games.
That seems reasonable, all things considered.
Matt, what do you think? How many starts does Ramo get, or whoever the starter ends up being?
Well, I would expect that Ramo, because of the contract and all that, would be the starter, and he'd likely get 45 to 50 starts. Personally, I would go with Berra as the backup full-time, and he'd get the balance. But if they go with McDonald, I could see a similar breakdown to what Luke said, with Berra being like a mid-season call-up type of thing.
Yeah, I personally don't like the idea of Berra being the backup, because I think he would be more effective either in Abbotsford or some other AHL team if we loan him out, playing a lot more games at that level. I think you guys have the right mix, and I think for Flames fans, it's going to be weird for us to have a starting goaltender who plays like 45 games, because we're used to Kipper, the Iron Man, playing 70. So I think it's something we're just going to have to get used to as Flames fans, that not everyone can play 70 games.
Well, that's part of the reason why I don't think it's a bad idea if Bear is up here full-time, because I appreciate that you don't want him being just sitting on the bench, but he's not playing behind Kiprasov. He's playing behind Kari Ramo, and Kari Ramo's done very little in this league. He's got a bigger contract than everyone else on the roster, but in terms of, like, okay, 2 years, $5 million, that's a pretty easy contract for to get out from under if you've got a goalie on your hands. It's still, like, this preseason they've had, what, two games each, or parts of two games? This season should be a full-out war between the goalies to get this job, because, you know, there's 30 number one jobs in the NHL. There is not a better chance, except maybe in Florida, to just grab one and don't let it go.
I agree with you that it should be a war, but I think that it's Ramo's job to lose at this point. So I think that he's going to start, McDonald will be his backup, and if he doesn't do a good job, I think it's going to be easy for the team to say, yeah, let's swap these guys. But I think the right strategy is to carry two goalies and just pick which one of the young goalies you want to keep as your starter.
It's one of those things where, you know, because they're unproven European goalies, like, if you've looked at in past years when you've got guys that have done good in their leagues coming over, like, about 40% actually take off and actually become decent NHL goalies, like Jonas Hiller or, you know, Backstrom with the Wild, you just don't know if they're going to adapt properly. And, like, when Hiller came over, like, he only had a few decent starts overseas and, like, didn't have a huge track record, and yet he came in and stole the job and was really good. So you don't know if Ramo or Berra would come in and just steal the show. You know, you need about 20 games each to see if they're going to actually take off with it. And that's why I would lend more to having both of them up to start the year, just because you don't know exactly what you've got.
But why not just start one of them and then give him, say, a dozen games, and if you're not happy, bring the other one up. That way one of them isn't sitting on the bench for 12 games or 24 games or whatever, and they can actually be playing at the AHL level.
Because you don't play them all at, you know, you don't give them 12 games in a row. You give them, like, two games each, game for game, play till one loses, etc., whatever. You can...
Yeah, like, that's the way I would do it.
And you keep... You know, because Berra's biggest thing, I think, is just not being accustomed to NHL shots. On the game-winning goal against Phoenix, the replay doesn't make that out to be the best goal for a prospective goalie to allow. He left a bunch of the net open up top, and that's something that, I don't know, as he probably gets away with at lower levels, but in the NHL, they burn you for that. And it's, I don't know, I feel like if you think both of those goalies are better than Joey McDonald, then both of those goalies have to be here.
How I would run it is, you win, you play the next game, you lose, the other guy goes in. So that way, each guy is getting roughly the same amount of starts, and that way, neither of them is sitting very long, and, you know, if one guy, like, goes and wins 7 games in a row, well, then, yeah, he should start those 7 games, and, you know, just run with it, because you don't know, that's the thing with all these young players, is that you don't know how they're going to adapt once they're in the NHL, so... You know, the more evaluation period that you can get for each guy, you'll be able to make a decision, oh, this guy's only this good, so we can replace him with somebody else down the road, type of thing.
No, and to be sure, the other thing is, like, if, say, you know, God will, like, I don't know the last time we had a 7-game win streak, but if a goalie wins 7 in a row and then loses, I would argue that he should probably start the 8th. Or the 9th, or the game after, whatever, however that works out. It would be the 9th game. You know, that to me is grabbing hold of the job. And then if he loses 2 in a row, mm-hmm. then you can... I guess we're debating semantics, I guess. This is a waste of everyone's time. Dan, what's our next topic?
You know, I think it's good that we have these kind of discussions, because this is one of the things that's been on Flames fans' minds, is what are we going to do with the goaltending tandem? And I think one thing that might be bugging the management, too, is to keep 3 goalies but have to send one more skater down. So they might be saying they don't want to get rid of another skater either.
That makes sense. I wouldn't want to.
So in that case, you have to carry 2 goalies. Not to say you can't swap goalies between the AHL and the NHL, but when opening day starts, if you don't want to send another skater down, you have to have 2 guys listed as goalies, not 3.
Yeah, yeah. Ramo Berra, 2014. Or 2013.
All right, there you go. Sounds like a campaign speech.
It does. It's a bumper sticker.
I want you to put that sticker on your car and drive around town.
My current car is a hunk of shit. I would be happy to deface it with a bumper sticker.
All right, we'll be looking for that. For the first time, and I think as long as we can remember as Flames fans, there was a question of who is going to wear the C this year. With Jerome leaving, we didn't have a captain for the last part of last year. And as we all know by now, Mark Giordano has been given the C, and Mike Camilleri and Curtis Glencross will be the alternates for this year. What are your thoughts, guys? Good? Would you pick someone else?
Well, my thoughts on captaincies is basically this. If you're named captain, it's one of those things where either you are or you aren't. So given that everyone sort of unanimously said Gio should be the captain walking out, then he's the captain. That's all there is to it. It was a no-brainer decision. The only thing I would say, Camilleri and Glenn Cross with A's, that makes perfect sense. The only thing I would have done a little bit differently, and they may yet do this because Camilleri and Glenn Cross is full-time A's, I would give Backlund and Brody A's, like one home, one away, and sort of rotate them in, night out, because I don't think in a pure rebuild like this, some of your young players have to assume leadership roles. And I understand why they haven't necessarily, because they just want Backlund and Brody to focus on getting better as players and professionals, and not worry about leading. That'll come next year. But it would be nice. I think maybe later on in the season, if their play dictates, we'll see that happen. But I hope it happens, at least for Brody.
And that has happened in the NHL level before, is having home alternates and road alternates.
Yeah.
So it's not out of the question.
No, not at all. And I really hope it happens, just because I gambled when I got my Flames. I sent my Flames jersey away to get crested, put Brody's name on it. I gambled with an A on it. So I hope that comes up good for me and him. Come on, TJ. Earn it. Earn it!
What do you think, Matt?
I had no problem with any of those three picks. Later on in the season, exactly what Lucas said, I can't argue with them at all. Both Backlund and Brody, they need to establish themselves as leaders on this team, and I think giving them an A down the road might help. And definitely next year, I think they should have A's as well, so... It might not be this year, but next.
I think these are good choices. I think these were the right choices for this year. I don't necessarily think these are the right A's going forward. And I also think that it's very possible that Mike Camilleri is not a Flame when this season ends. So if that happens, I think someone else like Backlund or Brody may end up getting that second A and wearing it into next year.
Mm. For sure. I will say this. As much as I approve of the choice of Giordano as captain... It looks weird on him. It looks...
Well, I think we're so used to seeing it on the same guy forever that it would have looked weird on anybody.
Yeah, I agree.
You know, I mean, Jerome was captain for how many years here?
10.
So anything looks different if you change it after 10 years.
Yeah, fair enough.
Be it your coach or the captain of your hockey team.
Yeah, and a neat fact is that Gio's the only undrafted captain in the NHL. So, oh, good for him.
Yeah, that's quite an accomplishment. Well, guys, looking down the training camp roster, I still have a couple concerns with this team down the middle. I don't think they did as much in the preseason and the offseason as they could have to shore up the center depth. We've seen TJ Gagliardi be moved to center and playing center a lot. Want to know your guys' thoughts on that and your thoughts on what we might do for center depth this year, or if you think the Flames are just going to kind of ignore it and... fix it in the coming years?
Well, addressing it partially by getting Monahan and Knight, you know, that at least for winning faceoffs is a good thing. I know Knight's not going to be here to start the year, but he should be up soon. Having Backlund, Stajan, and Monahan as your top three centers, that at least is a good start. Backlund, he won a lot of faceoffs during the preseason, so I'm guessing he was working with Monahan and Knight during the offseason on that, because he was markedly improved in that aspect. And realistically, going forward, we're going to need centers that are bigger like Monahan, just physically, because they're better able to win faceoffs. So guys like Jankowski and Knight, you know, they'll be better able to win faceoffs down the road. You know, it's not a finished product, but it is very much improved from last year. So, you know, it's baby steps, but it's better. So can't complain there.
And really,
what do you think, Luke?
Well, I think that it's a work in progress. I think it's as good as it was possibly going to look without us going out and signing Derek Roy or Tyler Bozak. But thank Christ we didn't do that. Oh my God. Good luck with that, Toronto. Basically, I mean, Monahan and Backlund are your longer-term pivots. Knight, you hope he turns into something, like a good third-line center. Stajan is a veteran center holdover. Okay. Gagliardi can play center, but he's there due to more a lack of experience down the middle than anything else. But, I mean, going forward, I mean, there's also Reinhardt on the farm, Jankowski in the NCAA, and Bill Arnold with Boston College. Like, there's center depth, and, you know, say stars align and, you know, we end up drafting, say, Sam Reinhardt next June, then we've got Reinhardt, Backlund, Monahan, Jankowski. Like, that's... Potentially, that could be the championship-caliber center depth we're after. Now, I think, given the overall levels of, I suppose, suck this team seems destined to achieve this year, and who's up the year after with McDavid, I think maybe we'd all secretly be rooting a little bit more for Ekblad than Sam Reinhardt, but the center depth, I'm not worried about. We're going to be drafting high enough for the next couple years that we will fill our center depth needs from the draft, and that's where you have to fill them from. Because, I mean... Aside from Joe Thornton, name me a bunch of true franchise number one centers that were traded in their prime for a reasonable return.
The only one other guy that comes to mind is Brad Richards, but you know, the Lightning had LeCavalier at the same time, so you know, they were rich in that aspect.
Yeah, I mean...
Yeah, like...
For sure.
You know, they just don't... They don't come up. So, like, it was weird that Jokinen even came available, and, you know, he's not even on that level. So, you know, it's... You have to draft them, and getting Monahan and even Corbin Knight, it's a step in the right direction.
A center that's listed on the roster that none of us mentioned was Lance Buma, who is still here. None of us said we would cut. So, he's a guy that's listed as center. Hudler's listed as a center on the website this year. So, yeah, we definitely have some depth there, and we also have some guys that can play wing or wingers that can play center like Gagliardi. So, I think that's always a big plus, too, when injuries start to kick in.
Yeah, well, plus if they get kicked out on a face-off, at least you have somebody else that kind of knows what they're doing. So you're not, you know, it's not an automatic face-off loss.
Although I think we can all agree it's much better to have centers playing on the wing than it is to have wingers playing center.
Definitely.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree with you. But, I mean, there have been some guys that have been successful as wingers, centermen. But, again, they're kind of rare, and it's a rare breed. And if you can get one of those guys, that's the kind of guy you want to hold on to.
Especially in fantasy. Mm-hmm. Patrick Sharp is the most versatile player in all of fantasy sports. He's a center, a right winger, and a left winger. If you don't draft him, you're an idiot.
That's a player whose position you just simply call forward.
Yeah. He's him and Dustin Byfuglien. Dustin Byfuglien, I don't know if anyone knows this. You probably do. You can play Dustin Byfuglien at right wing still in fantasy.
Oh, yeah.
Just, that's not fair.
Yeah, versatility is always best.
As far as, I mean, if you look down this roster at centers, like you guys all said, we don't have a big number one center. But like I said earlier, I think it gives a lot of guys a chance to prove themselves. I think we're going to get a lot of guys who aren't a number one center going forward, don't have a career as a number one center, but this is going to be their chance to lose that spot. This is going to be their chance to try it and see how they do. And I think when you push people to play higher than their level, you get the best out of them. So I think we're going to see the best out of a lot of these guys because we're going to give them first and second line minutes for at least a year.
Yeah, well, you have to view this upcoming season more as like a very extended training camp, because nobody's job is set in stone long term, because it's just the nature of it. Because there's so many roster spots that are open for the taking, that if you can be that 30-goal guy, you know, then go for it. And, you know, that spot will be open for you. So, you know, it's going to be a year-long battle for who can do what.
And that's what's going to make this interesting, right? Because God knows...
Oh, yeah. For sure. And in a season where we're not expecting playoffs, I think that's what makes it interesting, to see who earns jobs and who gets sent down to the farm and all that sort of thing. That's going to be the storyline that we as Flames fans are going to be following this year.
Honestly, if we finish higher than 27th, I'm going to be astonished. Just look, I don't...
Oh, yeah.
It's going to be rough. This team... The team last year, like... People gave us shit. It was like, oh, the Flames can't even tank right. It was a 48-game season. You give that team 82 games, they're going to draft Nathan MacKinnon or Seth Jones. Don't worry.
Oh, yeah, most definitely. And, you know, like, the Flames are the only team without a legitimate starting goaltender. So that kind of tells you right there that you're not going to be finishing too high unless Ramo or Berra turn into the next Henrik Lundqvist in the next, you know, 10 days.
Keep in mind, the Flames are the only team in the NHL without a legitimate first anything.
True.
Do we have a legitimate number one goalie? No. Do we have a legitimate number one D? No. In 18 months, maybe we... Or not 18 months. In 6 months, maybe we start considering Brody that. I see that possibility for him. But at the moment, no, we don't have that. Do we have a legitimate first number one forward? Nope. Now, do we have a legitimate first-round pick? Hell yes, we do.
But at the same time, would you expect anything different from a team that are in the hole the Flames are in and having to do a rebuild?
I'm thrilled to death about it.
To me, they're doing this right. They've done it right. They've got a good crop of young players. I'm optimistic about at least the start of this rebuild. I think that they're starting it right, and bringing a guy like Burke on to help with it, it's going to go smoothly, and we'll be back in the playoff hunt in probably 5 years, I think.
I would say three. That would, if we're looking at this as a success.
Unlike Edmonton and other teams, like, the Flames have already got a good group of third and fourth line potential guys, like your Reinhardts, your Ferlands, your Knights, your Horaks, already in place. Where, like, when Edmonton started their rebuild, they didn't have any of those types, and they were just drafting your Halls, your Nugent Hopkins, and that. So, like, we are already got the lower part of the roster already in the kitchen, so to speak, and they're already on their way to being NHL players. So, like, we're already ahead of the eight ball, so if we can get a Reinhardt, the Sam Reinhardt, or a McDavid next year, you know, like, those depth guys should already starting to establish themselves, so then once you get those star players, you might actually have a contending team on your hands, sort of like Chicago in, like, 08 and 09, where they were starting to put things together. So hopefully that's the case.
Yeah, I think that we've got all this, the supporting cast at this point. And like you said, it's just going to be a matter of once these guys start to gel together and really figure out how the NHL game works, we'll be able to slot in a couple big names, be them draft picks or free agent acquisitions, once we come out of this rebuild, and the rest of the team will be there and ready to go. So I'm really happy that that's the way they've decided to go about this.
Yeah, for sure. And while we're on the subject of the Oilers, Were the Edmonton Oilers brass not aware that there's, like, more picks than the first one? Because if you think about it, there's not a whole lot of great... as we've said, like, there's nobody else. There's the top picks. It's like their entire draft war room was about, Tyler, Nugent Hopkins, or whoever went second, Yakupov or Ryan Murray. Oh, do we need to take that? Ah, who cares? Yakupov. All right, call it a day, guys. Let's go smoke cigars. And
hold on, Luke. You're saying that once the cameras go off, there's more picks?
Apparently. It's where you get, like, Gaudreaux's and Sealoff's.
Your TJ Brody's and
Witherspoon's.
Maybe they should have just donated those picks they didn't want to us, and we could have drafted them.
Yeah.
In their defense, they do have two decent defensive prospects in Klefbom and Marinson that they did draft afterwards, and they are actually looking fairly decent. But, yeah, everybody else has been a steaming pile of... so...
But, like, you've...
Not every team can have a good draft.
No, but I mean, like, you are really gift-wrapped a situation, especially if you've got at least your first three picks. Where you draft first overall, you've basically got two first-round picks, and two first-round picks and a second just on your own. You should get two NHL players out of that.
Somebody, yeah.
And they haven't. They're terrible.
I know. And it's actually surprising how bad their drafts have been.
Yeah.
Considering you're guaranteed someone decent with their first pick. Like, yeah. Give me a break. Like, how hard is it? Oh, take the best player. You know.
Yeah.
Like, give me a break.
And you could really argue they've screwed up every single first-round pick they've had. It's not like Hall, Nugent Hopkins, and Yakupov have done a whole lot to cement themselves as being vastly superior options to the guy they could have taken.
No, for sure. And I've said this to anyone that I talk to about the Oilers. The other thing about that team is they've got a limited amount of time before they're going to have to blow that thing up due to cap restrictions when all those guys need to be re-signed. So really, they're on the clock. And if they can't get something going in the next couple of years, they're going to have to start the rebuild over again. If they can't
get something going this year, like... After this year...
Now.
Yeah, Nugent Hopkins is going to... His new deal's kicking in. Justin Schultz is also going to be... I think they can now negotiate with him. Now, he doesn't deserve a particularly huge deal. If anyone is worthy of a bridge contract, it's Justin Schultz. But knowing the Oilers are going to be like, oh my God, please love me. Here's 5 years, $25 million. Or they'll give him another $6+ million deal because they're... dumb. And Yakupov's
gonna be like they're gonna end up having like six guys and paying them like $40 million and, you know, wondering why they can't compete because they can't fill out the other 14 spots on the roster.
Yeah. Darnell Nurse is gonna... No, well, I mean, I don't know. I'm sure he'll be fine and he'll stick around. But, like, it's just... Nugent Hopkins is not worth that money yet. Be like, hey, dude, maybe you play a full season, and then we'll give you, we'll give you $40 million. How about that? Does that sound fair? Or, no, you're just gonna... Because you deserve it for... Fuck off. Nonsense. Utter nonsense.
So of all the woes that our team has, I think we can all at least say at least we're not in the place that the Oilers are in.
That's true. Oh, yes. Okay. But
isn't that true all the time?
Oh, I thank the heavens every day that I'm not in the position Edmonton's in anything.
Geographically, specifically. But let's just stay on this for just one second because, okay, what's the pressure to extend Ryan Nugent-Hopkins to that sort of deal? Because you hold all the power. Because if someone actually came out and gave him that offer sheet, wouldn't you take it and run?
Yeah, I'd consider it.
At the very least. I think that there's an optics thing going on in Edmonton, though, too, that if you lose him as an RFA, it's going to perhaps make the hockey ops guys there look bad, and they maybe don't want to put their job in that kind of jeopardy.
That's ridiculous. I mean, I understand that's probably how they're thinking, but that's a stupid way to think. Four first-round picks for a guy who's never played, more than 60 games? That's an utter no-brainer. And it's not like... you separate your shoulder a couple times, and then it just gets stronger because we've got like newfangled adamantium and whatnot. No, don't get me wrong. Nugent Hopkins is a great player, but if you offered me 4 first-round picks for him today, thanks for all the jersey sales, dude. It's not like you helped us win any games, but I mean, you made us some money.
This is why we're not in charge of the Oilers, because we'd make logical choices.
We'd be better at it.
Yeah, and that's good.
So do you guys think the Flames will be above or below the Oilers in the standings this year?
Below, but I don't think the Oilers are going to make the playoffs, because realistically, they have to beat out LA, Anaheim, Vancouver, and San Jose, and I don't see that happening.
And keep in mind, their big offseason additions are Boyd Gordon and Andrew Ferentz. I don't, for like a brief period in June, everyone was all about Boyd Gordon. And no one seemed to remember, oh, nobody cares. Boyd, who, $9 million for Boyd Gordon. Great, great job. And Andrew Ferentz. I liked Andrew Ferentz. I wished he'd signed here. But that defense was not an Andrew Ferentz away from being a playoff D.
Well, guys, I think it's probably about time to wrap it up for this episode. We'll be back shortly after the season starts. But before we do, there's one last thing I wanted to chat about. And I was talking to you guys about this before the show. I'm not all that happy with Sven Berchi so far. I don't think he's put in the effort that we need to see from him to be a top six forward in this organization going forward. And I really wonder how long he's going to last with this team. I don't know if he's going to go down to the AHL and play most of the season there. I wanted to hear your guys' thoughts on it. If it was me, I'd probably start him here, give him the chance. But if he can't get the job done, I'd quickly switch him out for somebody else from the AHL roster.
He seems like someone who, going forward, has no patience for stuff that doesn't matter. He didn't care about the prospect camp, and he, you know, clearly he's not the most involved in the preseason. I can't really fault the guy for that, though. You'd obviously like to see a younger player be a bit healthier, but I think he is a guy, he's a very smart guy. He recognizes he's had some durability concerns, so I'm sure he's not in a hurry to go bash his brains in for something that doesn't matter. I would also say that he's played 25 games. He ended the year on a 7-game point streak with nobody on this team to help him. I mean, he was probably... What was he playing with? Reinhardt? He had no help. He... Again, 25 games into his career, he doesn't like preseason and training camp. I'm not super concerned, and he's got so much talent and so much skill. And as much as Gordon Miller and Mike Johnson were giving him shit on the broadcast Wednesday night, you know, he made probably 3 or 4 excellent plays, and then he'd screw up and they'd be like, oh, rough night for Berchi continues. And it's like, okay, I guess that just doesn't fit your narrative, but it's not what's happening. He'll be fine. He's aware, I think, that he is being counted on as one of the saviors of the franchise, and I think he's taking the mindset that, like, okay, let's actually save the franchise when it matters, not in preseason.
Well, with his offensive talent, he will be an NHL player. Like, he's very good, and he can create plays all by himself and all that. The only concerning part in my mind is his consistency from shift to shift and during the shift, because sometimes, like, he'll just create a play out of nowhere and you're like, oh wow, how do you do that? And yet, like, earlier in the shift he was completely invisible. So, you know, if he can learn to be more consistent, then he will likely end up being a good top six forward. But just based off his talent alone, I don't see him being much worse than a guy like Yuri Hudler. You know, a solid 50-point guy that, you know, he'll chip points in here and there, but is more of a depth guy than someone that you'd actually rely on.
See, I think his skill set and part of what makes him so dangerous is the fact that he is, you think, okay, he's inconsistent within a shift, but that ability to disappear in the middle of a play, it goes both ways. Like, okay, yeah, you could disappear and you could leave a man unguarded, but if he's defensively responsible, that shouldn't be an issue going forward. But mainly it's like Brett Hull was famous for this, just sort of like melting into the shadows and all of a sudden he's wide open, gets the one-timer back of the net. Like, great scorers have to have that ability to sort of vanish, because that's, you know, it's what they do. And especially a guy like Sven, who's not the biggest or the strongest, like, he has to pick his spots. And also, he's what, 21 years old? Like, I think he'll be fine.
You just think maybe we have to wait it out a little bit?
It's 25 games in.
Yeah, okay, definitely. Like, you're only seeing just the beginning steps of his NHL career, so, you know, it's really way too early to determine what the final product would be when it comes to him.
Yeah, and in his 25-game NHL career, he's had a period where he scored 3 goals in 5 games, and he's had a 7-game point streak. Now, if that's one stretch of 25 games for a rookie, I mean, yeah, you'd want him to be a little bit more consistent, but you'd be like, all right, well, there's something here. Let's build on this. Keep doing it, Sven. And also, he was, what, the leading scorer on the AHL team during the lockout, or close to it?
Yeah, so really it's, you know, more talk to just try and get him to, like, a kick in the butt to get him to be more consistent when the games actually matter.
Yeah, don't let him off the hook for being lazy or immature or anything like that, but do remember that every second you spend criticizing Berchi is a second you could spend criticizing Butler.
Or the Oilers.
Yeah, exactly. And that's vastly more interesting.
Probably a better use of our time, too.
Damn you, Butler.
Maybe we'll have to do a show this year where all we do is bash the guys that we don't like.
Yeah. So the Chris Butler show?
We could do that. Someone should find out when Butler's birthday is. We can do it
I'm
around then.
I'm not heartless. I just don't want him on the team. I'm not about to ruin the man's birthday. Like, he's special to
I wouldn't put it past
him. Special to a lot of people. Just not... I don't know him personally. But, you know, I'm sure there's people in St. Louis, Missouri, who really think he's something else. He probably throws great parties in the summer.
Well, guys, we're narrowing in on an hour. Anyone have any final thoughts, or should we sign off?
I'm good.
Just to make sure, as always, that you either visit the website, follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/firesidechat, or on Twitter, we're at Fireside Podcast. Keep in touch with what we're doing, join the community, join the conversation, and I think it's going to be a fun season for all of us Flames fans if we can keep an open mind and realize what this season's going to be. And we'll talk to you guys again just after the season starts.
Go Flames, go.
Go Flames, go.
Suck it.
Oh, we are the boys of chorus. We hope you like our show. We know you're rooting for us, but now we have to go.
Fireside Chat Podcast, produced and edited by Dan Stevenson.